Welcome to the Eating Podcast, where we discuss technology and startups and invite some of the smartest people in Barcelona to share their opinions. The topic of today is the status for women in tech in Spain and where do we go from here? Because it's March and we felt it was, you know, in this place, we do this podcast every month and we felt that, you know, it's natural to invite some of the most brilliant women in tech in Barcelona and ask you and talk to you. I mean, how is it being a founder here? So around the table, I'll start from with you, Nina Alastruey. You're the co-founder and CEO of Eelp. We also have Helena Torras, she's the co-founder of B-wom, an angel investor here in Barcelona and also the board director of Fund of Funds. Last but not least, Gina Tost, you are the co-founder of Geenapp. You used to be the CEO of Geenapp. Tell us.
No, nothing. I just increased like the title of my COO to CEO so I can focus more on strategy on mid and long term and right. Not be on the daily day of Geenapp. And, well, be here and not to be always thinking about what's happening now at the office.
Mm. So it's a good feeling.
Well, it's like you're seeing your kid growing up and you need, you know, to be the kid, not your kid.
Right.
So it's great.
You're back to being the kid.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Oh, that sounds good. So to start off, I mean, being an entrepreneur in Barcelona and also being a woman, I mean, how is it? I'm just curious. Helena, you've been in the ecosystem for 10 years. I mean, that's a long time. I mean, what's your impression of being yourself?
Okay, being myself. Yeah. That's good. So thank you first for inviting me.
Sure.
So being an entrepreneur, and for me, it's the same as being a woman.
Hmm.
So it's... I'm a person, I'm an entrepreneur, but it's true that during 10 years it has changed a lot.
Mm.
And before you said you were an entrepreneur at the beginning, I remember 2009, it was like, okay, what's that? You are doing these things that only few people do, and we don't understand, and what's really that? But after so success cases that have been so much exits, I mean, being an entrepreneur or being an investor of entrepreneurs is something that now it's like fashion, and you have to be there. If you are not, it's you are. So, but also being a woman, so I think it's... It's not different from being an entrepreneur, but it's true that when I started, there were not so many.
Yeah, right.
So it was an advantage.
Yeah, it was an advantage.
Yes, everyone remember me. So it was easy if you went to an event and there were full of investors, all men. Now there are more women investors, but before there were all men. And the entrepreneurs, all men. So you were there, and I said, no, I have a project. So I'm a woman. They remember the woman that was in the cloud. Yeah, so they had something to... I was different.
Right.
That was enough so they could remember me, so I could follow up, and we had a different connection. So it was an advantage.
Oh, okay.
I don't think being a woman is a disadvantage, in fact.
No,
I think the
sure.
contrary.
Yeah. And Nina, for you as well, I mean, you've both been here and also in the States. I mean, you've been in the game for a long time as well. For you, I mean, how is it being an entrepreneur in Barcelona today?
I would like to say that I thought that, for instance, in the States was going to be quite different. I think being an entrepreneur and a woman is super tough, is super hard, super difficult. Maybe because I have two kids, and if I was single, it would be different, but... I remember when I arrived in San Francisco to open the company there, and in 2 weeks I went to a meeting with all the telcos. It was a GCMA meeting, all the telcos and big bosses of everything. And I was having a conversation with one of them before lunch. And we were talking, my last company was about mobile television, that was pretty new at that moment. And I was having a conversation, and at some point, the guy says to me, so what do you do at the company? And then I said to him, I'm the CEO. And then he said to me, are you the CEO? So what I understood is that I should be the marketing director. at that moment.
Really?
So this is something that happens always. Another question is, for instance, you used to go for beers with investors when you are an entrepreneur, and more in the valley. When some of them, because you really start very close relationships with some investors, and you know, first time you go for beers and with other entrepreneurs, blah blah, and second time is difficult because all investors have girlfriends, and it's quite different. And at the very end, you realize some of your friends go for beers with them, and you don't go for beers. It's like, why? I'm a woman, but you know, I'm not single. I already have. But you know, it's. But this is something that will happen always, and independently of the country you're living in. And the only thing we can do is to support other women, from my point of view. It's really tough, probably because, you know, women take a lot of social responsibility with kids, with moms, with elderly, whatever. And you need to empower them, from my point of view.
Right. I mean, Gina, I mean, you raised a company here in in Barcelona. I mean, compared to Nina's experience, can you recognize some of the same patterns?
Well, compared to Nina's and Elena's experience, I don't have the same amount of experience. I've been an entrepreneur for 4 years. I used to be a journalist, previously a tech journalist. Well, for me, it was, I won't say easy, because it's never easy, but because there was a group of women and a lot of entrepreneurs in Barcelona, it was kind of easy for me to get in, to know them, because everyone is empowering each other. For example, I didn't know Nina, but I know Elena, and even though we don't work together, I'm sure we can do a lot of things together in the same environment. So for me, maybe because the environment is more mature, we can increase you know, the empowerment and to help each other.
Right. And I mean, when you started out, was it as easy as it is today? I mean,
it's pretty new. I'm a noob. It's been only 4 years since I founded the company. It's going to be 5 years this year. But I don't have the same amount of experience as them.
Right. going forward, I mean, a big issue these days is getting women into more manager positions in startups. I mean, as you talk about, you know, you weren't expected to be the CEO, only the marketing person. I've been reading and studying before talking to you guys, and I've been thinking, I mean, startups itself, it should be a great way for women to early on get these kind of positions, right? Where, you know, in a big corporation, maybe it would be harder to rise to the top. Is that right? Or what do you think, Nina?
I think the startup ecosystem is a great environment for women.
Yeah.
And also because women are really talented. I mean, they are Absolutely. Complete people, from my point of view. they can manage many different tasks and startup needs this behavior. Corporates are different. So different wages, different responsibilities. You don't know why there's no a board member in.
For you, Elena, I mean, is this something that you also, I mean, you're meeting probably with female founders, I mean, founders of all kind of diversity. Do you think also that, I mean, for women with ambition, I mean, is the startup ecosystem a great place to start?
Of course. I think also there is a study of first round capital that they did after 10 years of investments that they say all the companies they had diversity on, they get a 63% more return on investment than the ones that had only male management team, male founders. So that, I don't think it's about male, female. It's about the diversity.
Right.
Because you bring different points of view, and that's what makes you richer. So it's not about having only women or having only men, but having both of them, and both views will make you increase. So startups, as Nina said, we women, we are more multitasking. And when you start a startup, you don't have money, so you have to multitask.
Right.
Yes,
right.
Or yes, you have to do everything. So that's an advantage for us. Huh. But I don't think, I really think it's a good ecosystem for women. I think it's an advantage to be a woman. I have two kids too, and I had it in the middle of everything.
Right.
The thing is, if you are a woman, you have to show ambition. I think the problem is not being a woman, but to have the ambition that the startup ecosystem wants about an entrepreneur,
right,
being a man or being a woman.
Mm.
If you are there, you show ambition, you have the vision, people want women.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, when you are investing in startups yourself, are you looking to the diversity when you're looking to invest in someone?
I look to the person.
All
not
right.
really, not. I would prefer to have more women projects. It's true there are not so many, and there should be more more people going, yes, I can.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end, I look to the person and how he is and how passionate is about the project. But it's true, when you really find a woman that it's passionate, ambitious, I mean, that's a project you have to invest in,
right,
because she's going to give all the soul. I'm not saying that men are not going to give it, but if the woman makes this step, she's going to give everything there.
Right, right. I guess she's talking about you. You have a diverse founder group at Geenapp. I mean, how has that been for you? I mean, to work alongside. I mean, do you think that you have some strengths that a startup that only women or only men doesn't have?
Well, our founding group is very diverse. We have Jaume Ferré, that he's a serial entrepreneur. He has founded a lot of companies. Mm. He had a lot of exits, and he's very successful.
Mm.
We also have Javier Casares, that he's a tech guy, a super freak that everyone in the tech area, freak area knows.
Mm-hmm.
And there's also me, that I used to be a journalist, but when we started, Jaume was more into the executive finance side of the company. Javier was in the tech side, and I was doing everything in between.
Right.
Because
you
have to multitask.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they saw something in me because they didn't say, okay, the girl, she can, serve coffee and do photocopies and things like this. No, they say, okay, let's work together. And the three of us are starting working together.
Hmm.
And we raise a kid that now is kind of big.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. I mean, when you're hearing this, I guess it's exactly what you're saying.
Yes.
That's
a woman entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Every investor is looking for.
Right, right, right. So I mean, so basically, all founders should look to some of these, I mean, multitasker women under teams. I mean, for you, you're a sole founder.
No. I co-founded the company with a business angel that is called Carlos Blanco.
All right, of course.
But he's not in the daily.
Okay, okay. So I mean, how does that work? That relationship.
It works. We meet every several days and discuss main matters.
Mm.
But he's not in the founding, so in the idea, in the.
Mm. Yeah, I understand. Yeah. I mean, going forward, I mean, you're not only entrepreneurs. I think we have established that. I mean, you're much more than that, and you're also role models. I mean, for people that are coming up now. I mean, you're nodding your head, but I mean, that's true. So, I mean, do you take that responsibility seriously, Helena? Do you think about it at all?
I said no. No, I don't think. I mean, if you say that, you are putting so much responsibility over us that I don't know if we want really to take
it. We already have a company, okay?
Yes, we're the startup. That's too much pressure. Then put more on us.
Yeah.
But I think it's not about being role model, but about talking between each other and talking about with other women that want to do it and saying, okay, I'm here. I haven't sold the company yet. I hope to have it, to sell it someday. But at the end, I'm doing my dream.
Yeah.
And why don't you follow your dream? So it's not about role model, but about sharing experience, about empowering, about giving visibility to other women, about making more visible all the community that yes, let's go and see what happens. Some right. will be successful, some no, but they will learn on the middle and maybe in the next one. So it's not, I would not put the pressure on the role modeling, but about sharing and about growing together.
Exactly. I mean, that's a very good point. But if tomorrow, I mean, if tomorrow there should be, you know, done some concrete, what can I say, concrete things, concrete move to make, to empower more women in Spain to be entrepreneurs. I mean, what should that be? I mean, and this is a big question.
But, I don't know.
you have no clue.
I don't know. I think that we have to work together and work in our project and things will come. I mean, there's no a path, I think. No. There's not a move. Like, we have to do this, and if we want to achieve that. No, it's a lot of things that a lot of people has to do, together or separately, that would lead us to, you know, to become a better tech hub.
It's hard work.
Yes, it's hard work, but everyone in their project, Nina with Eelp, Helena with B-wom, me with Geenapp, everyone with their project and with our own little success, daily success. Sometimes it's a daily success, like, hey, I didn't die today. Keep up the good work.
Right.
That are going to lead us to something, a better future.
Oh, that's cool. I'm curious, and I mean, we gotta dive into this a bit. But always when you read, and I do research before I talk to smart people like you, and I won't dare coming in here, you know, without any research. And I mean, what comes to me again and again is that women aren't taken as serious as men in some organizations. And I mean, Nina is telling how she, you know, your experience in the U.S.
It was just the first impression.
Just the first impression.
You get into the right. way they work and right. things are.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't know. This isn't like an established fact or anything, but I'm just curious. I mean, how what is your opinion? You know, on this in Spain. Have you, Helena, ever as a founder? I mean, has your opinions ever like been worthless to some?
On the contrary, I have a very positive view on everything. I've been, since I'm in the entrepreneur world, I think we should separate corporate world and entrepreneur world. It's different how it works. But for me, I've been taken seriously, not because being a woman or being a man, because me. That was my opinion, and it was taken seriously because it made sense. Maybe it has not made sense. I would not have been taken seriously as anyone. So I don't think, I don't think that being a woman it's a problem. It's true that it's the attitude also you show since the beginning.
So a lot about attitude.
Yeah, I think that, as I said before, as a woman we have to be able to do the first step and to let's go for it. All three of us, we have done that. But there are a lot of women that are thinking, should I do or not? But once you do it, you are treated with a lot of respect because you are there. You are following your dream and you are fighting to grow a company that started from zero, and you are putting everything, you're multitasking. So that's the respect you get.
Right.
As any male or any woman.
Because you talk, you know what you are talking, when you are saying, and people listen to you, not because you're a woman or a man, because you make sense.
Correct.
There's one thing that Helena said. The most important part is taking the risk. That is the most important part. So we have to empower people, take the risk, and feel the fear and do it anyway.
It's a leap of faith. You have to jump. You don't know if there's water, but you have to jump.
And this is maybe the biggest issue then. I mean, that not enough are taking this risk.
Yeah.
So how can we change that? I mean, that's a huge question. But I mean, why did you take the risk personally?
I did it because I believed in the idea of the company. Because there was a problem in the market, and we tried to find a solution to solve it. And I mean, we went for it. That's why I took the risk, because I believed not in myself but in the idea, and I thought, okay, maybe I can add some value to the project and I can help increase the, you know, to be a company, not just a PowerPoint and an Excel file. But then I don't know what we have to do. I don't know. I really, really don't know. Maybe it's about seeing your parents do it differently, maybe at school. I don't know. Maybe media.
I mean, Nina, why did you take the risk? Why did you jump?
I must say that I thought many times I was going to start a company. And at that moment, I always thought, oh, no, I'm not ready yet. And this is something that happened to me because I'm a woman, I'm sure. Now I see myself as a person first. But I thought about the company many times before I had started.
And this is like a characteristic that, I mean, you go over things more deliberately maybe than men do. I mean, you think about more things. I mean, that thing can go wrong or...
No. No, but men... This is about society. Yeah. So men... are taught to be free. So I feel free, but I feel free now, or since 10 years ago.
Yeah.
But they feel free since the very beginning, and the world is for them. So they get ready for whatever. In the women are different. So women are taught more in relation to others and the importance in relation to others, in relation to a partner, in a couple, in relation to a family, and it's about breaking these models.
Right.
We have to, but we're helping. We're helping just by doing it, and I see that with my friends. And I really enjoy giving advice because I know what they are expecting. So when a friend that is not in the startup ecosystem asks you something, in my case, they are asking you a different point of view. And I really enjoy that because I feel super free always. And I say always what I think. And this is very interesting. So, and they look for you, Nina. This is happening to me in the office. What would you do? Oh, please, why are you handling that? Why don't you go and talk to whatever? And I just say what I feel I would like to receive.
Right. I mean, that's very interesting, and that's brilliant. Moving a bit forward with this, I mean, we all, before March, I mean, there was all this Uber incident, Susan Fowler, I mean, being very open about these things, and there's been, I mean, a huge aftermath. And reading, you know, a lot of technology news here from Spain, you very rarely hear about these kind of news here. But is it because it doesn't exist, or is it because... people doesn't speak about it, or is it because, I mean, we solved it? I mean, what do you think, Gina?
I think that we take everything that it's normal, something like this. It's normal in our society. Tech environment is not more, how do you say it in English? Machista?
Macho?
Macho.
I think that this happens in all the layers of the society, not only in a company, but also in a bar, in a football field, in a playground. This is happening everywhere. So we need to point. I think it's not about pointing out what's bad, but pointing out what's good. And to normalize something like, hey, we are CEOs of our own companies and we are empowered and we can do whatever we want. Because this is who we are. We don't have to live in fear of relationship. We don't have to live in fear like, could I be possible to do so? Or no. You have to empower yourself and say, hey, I'm a woman and I'm a person. I'm a human being and I can do whatever I want because this is my life and this is my body and this is my society, my family, my friends. So go for it.
Right. Oh, that's a good speech.
Yeah. Let's go.
Yeah. See, you're sitting there like, yes.
She inspires me.
Yeah. Oh, that's great. I mean, and I agree. I mean, of course, we should focus on the positive things and the empowering factors. And there are some things going on in Barcelona. I mean, there are some forums for women in tech, women in mobile. Are you involved in any of this in any way? Both.
Women in tech and women for tech and women in mobile, for example. Yes, we're trying to group ourselves in an environment that we feel comfortable.
That's what it's all about, you know, creating an environment where you can...
I don't think it's only being comfortable, but being visible.
Yeah. Mm.
So I think that's the point of all the initiatives about women in tech, with all the different names and all the different organizations.
Mm. Right.
But at the end, it's making it visible, seeing there are a lot more than you think. And let's make it visible for the corporates, for the startups, and for the new woman that will join, so they can go on. There is a community.
You can be visible by yourself, but it's better if you go with a group.
Yeah,
right,
go
right.
together.
Yeah.
It's.
And do we have enough of these kind of groups, these kind of forums, or is it?
I think there are too many.
Really?
In the sense that there are so much spread that they are not visible enough because they are small. So what we have to do, and there is already one initiative working on that, to the umbrella and group all together.
All right.
So it's stronger because you all go together, all with each specialization, you know, mobile, gaming, or whatever. It's with their own identity, but being woman in tech as a whole group.
Right.
I think that's the point. If you are together, you're bigger.
Right, right.
If you are just spread, you're smaller. It's like individual to group, so let's make a bigger group. And there's already one initiative going on that.
Okay, so things are happening.
Yes.
Okay, we'll hear news
soon.
Cannot
disclose more, but yes.
It's secret. Okay, very interesting, very interesting.
I think in any case that we need decision makers.
Right.
If we don't have people able to take decisions in business matters... So women in mobile or in tech are great. We love them. Beautiful. But we need people making business. And this is very important. So we need people in the high, whatever corporate is going to buy technology in whatever.
Right.
And the more we have people on top positions, the more we will.
Oh, that's interesting. I mean, as a shift this year, we've been seeing more and more corporate activity within the startup world. I mean, corporate are moving, you know, in the community and both are talking, investing, partnering with startups, right? Is it a problem that, I mean, these corporations are often filled with men on boards, men in CEO positions? Is this an issue? What do you think?
I don't know.
You don't know?
Maybe they can answer better than me.
What do you think, Nina? You brought it up.
You know, what happens is that men are very corporate and they do sport together. They go and play golf. It's very difficult to find a man or four men and a woman in a golf cart together. Or they go wherever. They share their hobbies and they can do business at the moment. And on our side, we have to wait for office hours to do the business. Or they go, let's say, Rotary, or they go wherever. So the things are changing, but there's still a lot of this business way of doing. And
That's some good questions. I mean, you're an investor yourself, and I mean, a lot of more corporates are coming into the game now. What do you think for diverse teams to prosper? Does it matter that corporates are, as Nina is pointing to, a lot of men? Does it matter at all, or doesn't it matter?
It matters sometimes. I think she made a point, and it's the fact of the networking. I mean, there are a lot of relationships that are influenced by knowing someone. At the end, if you have to choose between one company and another, you choose the one you think you will trust more. And it will be because you know the people who is behind. So at the end, if you know the man and not the woman, probably choose that. It's not because you don't think the woman are talented enough.
Right.
It's because you have more knowledge about this person, so you trust, it's a doer, and it's going to deliver it.
You play tennis with him, you play...
No, but I don't think it's not that, but you have trustful relationship. So networking, it's something, what we have to change is the rules of networking. So we can do networking with men, different ways.
Yeah.
It's just changing the rules. Okay, should I disclose my secrets? No, the thing is, there are a lot of events. So it's you have to go there. Women tend to go home You have to go there.
Yeah.
You have to be there.
Be visible.
It's difficult schedule. Okay. Just reschedule. You have to go there.
You go to the events and then they go dinner and you go. With
I
you
go. Home. No, I go dinner too. No, I go dinner too. And yeah, it's true.
That's not happening. So it's. Not
it's
easy.
True that
it's
sometimes I'm the only woman on the table.
Hmm. And but, then your family has to understand that.
Yeah.
That you are not there for preparing dinner or to at night. And
yeah, but you know the husband can prepare the dinner too.
Yeah, yeah, but so but they have to understand. It's not about. You, yourself, your life, your
correct,
body. It's about your family, your friends also. Because, hey, I have to go to, I don't know, I have to go to the valley to close an investment round, or I have to go to, they have to understand that you are not going to be for the barbecue on a weekend. You have to be somewhere
I think
else.
That's true. And also when you look for the partner, not, sometimes women don't make the step further because it's a partner who say, okay, no, you have to do the dinner or whatever. I think that we have to be choosing your partner in life. That's really critical because at the end, it's you're a team. If you really feel you are a team, that's not an issue. That's right. My case. I have a team and, you know, we are a team. Yeah. And we know when we have to prioritize one thing or another. It's true that I'm really square too and I have my own rules. I go to dinner only from this day from week until the other. This is for family time. And but I have to go to dinner and I have to do these things. And you establish relationships and you are not treated different because you are there. But networking, it's a huge point to take into account because it's about trust, and especially in startups, because at the end, and I changed to investor side instead of entrepreneur side. If you invest in companies on the early beginnings, you're trusting, you're investing in faith. You're saying, yes, they will do it. So it's about relationships. That's why all investors say the team is the most important thing. Because it's this team going to be able to do this idea and to make it bigger, big. Because at the end, the idea, it's worth zero.
Yeah.
No, it's how you execute that. So that's trust.
Yeah.
How you trust knowing someone. How you know someone. The more time you know this person, the better. So that's how we have to change. And I think these events about women in wild, all these things, what are doing, it's, hey, woman, go out this afternoon to an event. At the beginning, it will be only woman. But at the end, we have to try that the events are completely 50-50.
Right.
Not only woman, not only men. They are mixed. And that everyone goes and feel comfortable there. And so I think trust is really the key word on the startup world. Once you are having 3, 4, 5 million revenues, that's another history.
There
are numbers. But at the beginning, you don't have these numbers. And you are looking for money. You are looking for investment. Why are they going to invest in you? So that's why also there are so many companies. They say that women-founded companies are less invested by men, are less invested than men-founded companies. One thing. First, you invest in someone you feel very empathic. I feel more empathic with her maybe than with a man. So I will tend to invest more on her because I know how a woman works. So that's the same for men. So take into account that there are more men investors, they invest in more men entrepreneurs. So that's not, they are just discriminating. It's because that's human.
So we need more women investors then.
Yeah. So we need more women investors. The second thing is sometimes the products, and it's not the case. In my case, yes, but it's not the case from Gina and from Nina. Gina, Nina. But they don't understand the product. It's there is an history in the US about Birchbox, you know, the box that you deliver, that's long time ago, and that they went to raise for money, and the investor said to the secretary, can you come? You would buy that? It's really that a good idea? So that's not the way to take a decision about ideas. So that's why now there are more woman-led funds trying to invest in woman-led companies or companies that are woman-oriented. Because they can understand what's the product for.
Right.
So that's the different mindset. It's not just about gender of how we behave, but It's because we think different, we act different, we consume different. So we have to understand that. And once you understand that, you see there is a business behind.
Right.
And if you, there is a business, there are more men jumping in.
Words of wisdom. So we're running a bit out of time. I mean, a great discussion. But before we end up, I really want to just take the round, because I mean, it's all about promoting each other here. And I just want all of you to mention one startup in Barcelona that has a diverse team that you really like. That you really want to like. These guys are going to do great things.
I have to think. There are plenty.
There are a lot.
There are a lot. I mean, you're allowed to say two.
Only two.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Okay.
I mean, you're meeting people all the time.
Yeah. Team EQ and Social Car.
Social Car, Team EQ.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nina?
For instance, a Mocha platform, people from Inoquan, and they are a founder and a co-founder, a man and woman.
Oh, cool.
Interesting. So big data, mobile big data management.
Very interesting. Last but not least.
I don't know. Maybe B Energy, that it's a company that is using is using gamification for health. And Helena knows it because of B-wom, her startup. They can do, I think there's a lot of things that they can do together, because it is something that maybe we have to learn. Maybe this is next step, that we collaborate with each other, like, hey, I have a startup that is doing this and you are doing that, maybe we can do things together.
I was hoping you would say that, but then that wasn't my third one. I said, okay, Gina will say.
Perfect. So thank you so much, every one of you, Nina, Helena, and Gina, for coming, and thank you for listening to the podcast, everyone. Be sure to check out the videos, the blog post, everything related to the podcast, and also the podcast we're going to do next week.